I've never seen one this bad before. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, that's gone.
Wow.
But it's interesting to see how slab cut fractures.
Yeah. Wow, yeah. This is a weeping willow back. So.
It's weeping now.
Yeah, it's definitely weeping. It's crying tears of blood. My name is John Daly. I'm the workshop manager and I repair and restore violins.
My name is Colin Schofield. For the last 12 years, I've been repairing and making string instruments.
My name is John Crumrine. I'm a bow maker.
My name is Michael Hardery and I'm a luthier. I specialize in the repair, restoration, and setup of violins, violas, and cellos.
Well, you could approach it from a forensic point of view. If you have a lot of scratches and dings on this side of the fingerboard, you know it's been plucked very aggressively. Other times when you find corners that are missing, or chewed up, you know that the violinist might have a very aggressive approach with the bow. I came across a violin in Italy at my friend Bruno's workspace that had a burn mark in this area. And I asked him the story behind that, and he explained that it was an old French violin that had been played in a cafe, probably by a jazz musician, and that violinist was smoking at the same time he was playing it. So the ashes would fall off the cigarette and rest on the top of the violin. The result was a small burn mark in that area. You can get a lot of stories off of one violin. It definitely collects the history of its players.
Well, certainly I think everyone has, or most people seem to have an affinity for older things. There are certainly old instruments that sound wonderful, but there are plenty of new instruments that sound equally good. So it's a little bit more just the aura and the, I don't want to call it prestige, but just the feeling that you get that you're the caretaker of something that's old and has a lot of history to it.
I believe that most makers have a diverse background. I feel you need to know the history of your craft to be able to focus within it. My focus has always been to try to understand how to read an instrument, how to say, okay, I can't get this instrument to be powerful, but I can get this instrument to be very, very sweet and responsive, and being able to produce that for the player.
I used to be a musician, and I always went to violin shops, and I was always hands-on, and I thought that I could learn to do violin making, and I realized after exploring that a bit that it's very complicated, and I thought bows were simple, and I learned that bows are not very simple, ultimately. There's a lot of complexity, and it sort of overtook my being a musician to being a craftsperson. Bow making is different from violin making because it's metalworking. Making each end of the bow is making this portion, which is metal and seashells and ebony. And it's just a lot of different materials and a lot of different technical work. It's carving, it's machining, it's sawing, it's planing, it's filing, it's a lot of different things.
Most people have no idea what a luthier is. The word comes from the old Italian word lutaio, which originally meant lute maker in the Renaissance, and that was the popular instrument to make, so lutaios were lute makers. At the end of the Renaissance, eventually, the violin gained popularity, and all those who were making lutes changed to making violins. So lutaio, currently, technically, really means anyone who works or builds string instruments. You know, today luthiers have two responsibilities. They have the responsibility of making new instruments, and also a luthier is somebody who restores the older ones and preserves them, kind of rejuvenates and gives them a new lease on life.
This is a about 280-year-old instrument, and it was dryness, humidity problems, and where it was being stored that caused a lot of old cracks that had previously been repaired to open, as well as some new cracks. A lot of times you can repair cracks from the outside without removing the top plate, but in this instance we had to take the top plate off to properly glue and then secure the cracks.
The wood selection is really important. Historically, France and Germany had large-scale productions, thousands of people making instruments and parts and strings and cases, and it only makes sense now that that's happening in China. You know, woods like this wood has to sit and age from the time it's cut for about 30 years before it's usable. And when you're making large production of an instrument, you need materials that are viable. And to make an instrument in southern China and have it be viable in New York in the same year, with all the weather shifts and the different climate, it's really difficult to do that. I don't think that the art is dying. I don't think that there is a loss of information. I think actually now we live in a time of information. You can go online and learn a lot about violins and bows that you couldn't learn before the internet was really available. I think it's going to continue to flourish. And the big difference, I think, now in violin making and bow making is it's done worldwide.
The process of apprenticeship really is the art of imitation. This is the kind of industry that you'll spend a lifetime learning about things in every department, but still at the end there's always still something to learn. So I don't think there's an official end to an apprenticeship.
One of my first masters told me that I could become a doctor and make a lot more money in far less time than it would take to become a master luthier. I don't think we're as important as doctors, frankly, but I think the musicians might think we're that important.
My goal has always been to produce a violin and make it as best as I can until the day I can no longer make. And restoration and repairs I've focused on those to improve my making. But I'd say not every violin maker focuses, every luthier focuses on making. I would like to see my brand and my violins get played on by great musicians.